the people and tell the devil you're a liar. You're not going to take my land. You're not going to take this city.
It is your faith. It is your faith that's going to help them.
We glorify you. We glorify you in your house, my Lord.
Looking to the land of a love that never ends. How great it is. You came into my life and now everything is right. How great it is. I'm living, 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 living my best life.
We praise you, our King. We glorify you. Jesus, are we ready to dance a little bit?
Jesus. Slide to the left, hey. Slide to the right, whoa. Give him all you got now. Give him all you praise now. Slide to the left, hey. Slide to the right, whoa. Give him all you got now. Give him all you praise now. Slide to the left, hey. Slide to the right, whoa. Give him all you got now. Give him all you praise now. Slide to the left, hey. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. Everything is better with you. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. You are the way, the truth, and life. You are. Everything is better with you.
We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, our Lord. Jesus.
I've seen you do it before, and I believe you can do it again. You are all powerful. God, you're on the throne, and we all know you can do a miracle. You're the Lord of all. You're able, yeah, you can move the mountain, there's no doubt about it, you're able, yeah, I know you can, nothing is too hard for you, I know you can, there is no other, nobody greater than you. This praise away. I'm holding on tight to you.
Jesus.
You're the only one who makes a way. You can do a miracle. You're the Lord of all. You're able. Yeah, you can. You can move a mountain. There's no doubt about it. Too hard for you. I know you can. Nothing is too hard for you. I know you can. There is no other, nobody greater than you. Working all things for my good. Too hard. Nothing is too hard for you. Jesus, you always be good. There is no other, nobody greater. I know you can.
Again, mighty God, we honor you, Lord.
He who came in power, he will come again. And he who heals the sick, won't he move again? And he who raised the dead, won't he raise again? And I will sing, I will sing. Thank you.
because I trust you. I sing because I love you, and I'll bring my heart, I will lift my song. Yes, Lord, we love you, Father. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Lord. Praise you. This night we give you all the honor.
Your melodies, you surround me with your song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Let us sing of freedom.
Children of God, do we have in this place? Jesus, we praise you, our King. We glorify you. We magnify you, our Lord. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. Fear is what sets us, keeps us in captivity. Fear of what would others think about me. What if I do this wrong and I'll never get it right? That's fear. I think others are talking about me. What are they saying? That's fear. When you realize that, you know what? I'm a child of God. I've been bought by the blood of Jesus. I don't belong to myself anymore. You don't belong to yourself anymore. You belong to Jesus. His blood has paid for you. You don't have to walk in shame anymore. Surrender to God, trust Him, and know that you are a child of the kingdom of heaven, and your inheritance comes from heaven. You are not of this world. We're passing through. This world sometimes seems like it's everything, but really it's a small part of our life. Because life eternal is forever and forever and forever and forever, and eternity never ends. That's when you hear stories of those that have died and come back, and they still had minds, they still had thought processes, but they weren't in their bodies. And that's why it's important for us to prepare today for our eternal destination. And I don't want any of you to miss out. Jesus, I love the words of Jesus when he said, if you hear me, if you hear my preachings and you listen not, I didn't come to judge you. I came to save you. Jesus didn't come to judge us. He came to save us. But we all know there's judgment day one day, amen? That judgment day will come whether we like it or not, whether we're excited or not excited about it. Every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There's every single creation you see and do not see has been created by the mouth of my Father. My Father spoke it into existence and it came to be. You have been spoken into existence. And you came to be in your mother's womb. Jesus has restored the bridge back to our Heavenly Father. And so we honor our King. We honor Jesus. I want you to let all those baggage go in your heart. Every heaviness go in the name of Jesus. Every pursuit of happiness that is a lie go in the name of Jesus. Every pursuit of everything that's not for you and God has not given that avenue to you, go in the name of Jesus. No longer live in fear. He wants us to have dominion in everything, even our finances. Everything has given us for us to have dominion over, not for it to have dominion over us. Amen. We shouldn't bow down to our jobs before God. We shouldn't bow down to things and reverence those things before our God. We need to reverence God and know that God has given me dominion. God has given you dominion in the name of Jesus. And when you put Him first, when you put Him first in your life, in your heart, with your time, with your finances, He will open doors that man can only be in awe of. How in the world could that happen to that guy? How in the world could that happen to that girl, that woman? is because that's a child of God right there. That's a child that doesn't walk in fear, but walks by faith in the name of Jesus. Let's sing that one more song, time. Oh, one more time.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
I'm surrounded, I am
surrounded
by the songs of deliverance. Surrounded,
we've been liberated
from our bondage. We're the sons and daughters.
We're the sons and the daughters.
Yes. The sons and the daughters.
We're the sons and the daughters.
Let's sing. Let's
sing our freedom. Oh, 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 oh.
Our King is around the corner. Our Savior is around the corner. I see him breaking through those clouds. Jesus, 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 we love you, Jesus. And celebrate him, and celebrate him on Sunday, our Easter celebration, amen. We love you, Jesus. Bring families to him. It's not funny. Bring families to him. People are going to hell without Jesus. There's no other way. There's only one way, and we need to take it seriously, amen. Like we love somebody. Like we love somebody, amen. Not ashamed because we love them, and they're worthy to talk about Jesus too, and invite them to Easter celebration. If you have a hard time talking, get some flyers back there. But bring them to Jesus. Just like someone brought you to Jesus. Don't be selfish with Jesus. Amen. We love you, our King. We glorify you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
He is risen.
Get ready, Living Word.
It's our Easter Sunday service and picnic.
This March 31st.
Remember, we're going to be having services in both churches.
And in the end, we're going to come together at our India location.
So bring the whole family down.
We're going to have food, music, raffles, games.
It's going to be an Easter egg hunt for the young ones.
Come and celebrate with us and celebrate the King.
Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise.
Resucitado. Iglesia, acompáñanos a celebrar la resurrección de nuestro Rey. Este domingo 31 de marzo tendremos servicios en los dos templos, Indio y Desert Hot Springs. Al final nos reuniremos en la iglesia de Indio. Habrá comida, música, rifas y premios. Ven a celebrar a nuestro Rey.
Ladies, it's devotion time. Come connect with us Wednesday at 10 a.m. Be here at 9 a.m. for prayer at our Indio location. And don't forget to bring your coffee mug, Delight Devotions, Ladies Bible Studies, and Fellowship. Can't wait to see you there. God bless.
Come on, somebody. Someone got to get excited in this place. God is good. I said, God is good. All the time. I don't know what's taking place in your life, but God is good. God's doing something. Blessings to each and one of you, to your families. Blessings to those who are watching from home. We're excited you're able to watch from home. Maybe we'll look forward to seeing you here Sunday. It's going to be a powerful Sunday. We're going to do what we do best as a church. We're getting right into it, okay? You need an envelope, raise your hand. Envelope has all the information you need for credit cards, checks to Living Word. If you're giving by your app, do so. There's also a little barcode in front of you. You can take a picture, and it'll take you straight to giving. I want to share this with you. In Mark chapter 11, verse 24, Jesus said, "Therefore I say to you, whatever thing you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." That is power. This evening, when you sow your seed, I want you to believe. As you pray for whatever it is, believe that it's in your hands already. It's already there. You have to believe it because it's yours already. Are you ready to pray as you sow your seed? I'm going to pray. But I want you to pray for whatever is taking place in your life. I know God's going to take care of it. I know God's going to meet the need. I know God's going to restore it. God's going to give it to you right in your lap. It's not cost you nothing. God's just going to give it to you. You ready? Then Heavenly Father, I want to say thank you, God. I want to say thank you, Father, because your word is your word. It never changes. And if you say to pray about something and believe it, and then it's ours, then that's what we're doing tonight, God. This evening, Father, I want to say thank you, Lord, for everything that's been taking place, not just in my life, but in the church. I want to say thank you, Father, for all the restoration that's taking place, Father. I thank you for all the healing, Father God, all the breakthroughs, Father. I thank you for all the new families, oh God. I even want to say thank you for the new buildings that are coming our way. Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Because this year is different than any other year. This year, your favor is upon your people. This year, God, we will see you move like never before. God is healing some people in this room right now. Get ready, church. God is shifting some things around in the favor of his people right now. Some of you have been asking God for something. God's going to meet your needs. He's going to take care of it. Thank you, Lord. Have your way tonight, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
So shall we praise him one more time to service, amen.
Enter your gates with thanksgiving and enter your courts with praise. Join in together and sing. Oh, how I love this place. Today is the day of salvation. Miraculous turnaround. The kingdom of God is amongst us. Oh, how I love your house. I just love. I love the house of the Lord. I just love. I love the house of the Lord. Hey! Hey! Privilege. Thank you, Jesus.
the house of God. The house that brought deliverance to your life and to your family, and let Jesus into your heart. Never forget what God has done in his house, in your life, in the life of your family. That's what you always remember. I love his house. I love the house of the Lord. And I love that song. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Father. We glorify.
Lift up those holy hands that the Lord has blessed you with. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, the house that you have already called before the foundations of the world, to be together to worship you in this Tuesday night, and to see a breakthrough and healing and power of God to unite the humanity, the heart of people, to love you in the name of Jesus. Turn to somebody and tell them God loves you. Tell them I love you. And you can have a seat in God's presence when you're done. How many are good, are glad to be in God's house this evening? Come on. Well, we are heading into some beautiful times. Yes, we are. I have a message here for you that I really want to just share. I'm sure it won't come out all of it because it's a lot, but it's going to be very exciting. And then I can't wait for Sunday. I guess I'm the only one that can't wait for Sunday. So, you waiting me to be a cheerleader or what? I can't wait for Sunday just to love Jesus, see new family, see who you're gonna bring. Yeah, see who you're gonna bring around. I'm gonna share something with you right after church about something else that the church needs your assistance. Turn to your neighbor and say, you know, God's house needs you. Come on now. Yeah. I want you to go with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 42. The book of Genesis, chapter 42. I'm going to have a nice Bible study today. And I'm going to title this, Are You Willing to Face Your Past? Are you willing to face your past? ¿Estás listo para enfrentarte con tu pasado? Are you willing to face your past? And I want to help you here by understanding that at times the word says forgetting the past. And so you might say, well, Pastor, why do I have to face my past when the Bible says to forget my past? Well, very simple, because it's talking to the ones that haven't been able to forget their past. It's not talking to the ones that already, you know, got their breakthrough. It's talking to the ones that haven't been able to forget their past. And the reason is because they haven't repented. How do you know if you haven't repented from it? Well, do you lose some sleep over it? Does the Holy Spirit just bring it to your remembrance? Have you spoken to that individual and made things better? Or have you asked God to forgive, you know? Or that person might be maybe gone, no longer alive, but there's still something there. And it's eating you up, and it's hurting you, and it's destroying you, and there's no joy, But God wants to give you that joy, that peace, so you don't have to carry that conscience and that guilt in your life. Come on now. You don't need to have that. Oh, Father, we're going to come before you in the name of Jesus. Before I read the word, I'm just going to pray. Father, we just love you. Let this word be life-changing. Rearrange people's furniture in their hearts. Heal their lives, Father. Let us be honest with each other. In Jesus' name. Somebody say amen with me. Good. Genesis chapter 42. And it's going to be, I'm going to minister on Joseph. A little bit on Joseph. And I won't be here too long on him because, you know, that's a long story. Actually, this is a series. I'm just really giving you a little bit. But this is a series of probably parts, like nine, almost like 2 months of a series. So I'm just giving you like a little bit. Genesis 42. Are you willing to face your past? Jacob sends his sons to Egypt. I won't read all of it. I'm just going to skip through it because it's a lot. I have to read through all the way down, and so for the lack of time. But here is Jacob. He sends his sons to Egypt. Let me give you a little history before that, a little background. Remember that Jacob, he was the favorite, the son, you know, with the coat of many colors, and the son that had the favor on him. The favor of God was on him. Not that it was on the other guy, but there's something special on him. And remember that the brothers got jealous and all that. They threw him into the pit. They sold him as a slave and left him there for dead. And they went over there to his dad, and he said, "Dad, you know, Jacob, you know, our brother is, we found this, and there was blood." And they put blood of an animal, and they said, "Our brother's dead, and the father is, you know, he's crying." There's some mean brothers there, right? I don't want no brothers like that around my life. No brothers like that. I don't want throwing me in the pit, telling my wife I'm dead. Talking about, you know, he's dead. No. So all that came with envious and jealousy. Because, you know, why not me? Why him? Jacob is spending too much time with Joseph. All this is going on. Time has passed by. We see that Joseph is going through it. He's helping Egypt by his gifts as a slave. Potiphar sees that Egypt is prospering because of the thoughts that he has and the ideas that are given from God. And so they say, "Joseph, come over here and help us out." He's still a slave, but he's inside the palace now and helping out as a servant. Later on, you know, here comes Potiphar's wife, and Potiphar's wife looks at Joseph. Joseph is a very young man, and he's in there, you know, looking fresh from a different tribe. You know, he's got the favor of God on his life, and that lady knows it. Potiphar's wife wants a piece of Joseph. And she says, "Come and lay with me." And Joseph runs because he won't disrespect his boss's wife. That's one thing. The other thing is, too, is that he's not going to do something that the Lord knows. He's watching. He's watching everything. And he's not going to. He says, "I'm already a slave. What am I going to do? Kill my life over here over this one broad." It's not going to happen. Anyways, right? What happens is he runs. She pulls from his clothes, rips it, and says, rape. He didn't do anything. He's thrown into jail. And there, they leave him. He's among the prisoners. One thing leads to another. God, if you didn't do anything wrong, and God's favor is with you, you're gonna see justice in your life. God, justice will come upon your life. Justice will come. Doesn't matter when, justice will come. God's favor. Here we go. He gets God's favors on him. He interprets some dreams. One thing leads to another, because I don't want to go through all that story. And then he becomes Potiphar. He becomes the ambassador, the most powerful man in the world besides Pharaoh at that time. Joseph becomes the most powerful man in the world. Besides, Pharaoh was there, but he becomes that most powerful man in the world. But he went through all those trials, everything he went through. And here's where I start. And I don't want to say this, because I heard someone say this, and I try to write it down as precise as I can, because I was really, when you hear something, I was writing it down. But it's talking about life and destiny. Say it with me, life and destiny. Life and destiny, they're two different things. And I'm gonna show you this. Every person has sometimes in their life, they're going to choose either life or destiny. What makes life is when you just decide to live pleasing yourself and you become successful at it. But you still have chains upon your life. You still have a curse lurking over you. Still, there's still something above you that's holding you down. You're living life. You might have some money in your life, might be working hard for life, but you're not free in life. Then there's destiny. See, you can decide to be something different. You can decide to be what you want to be. But God has destined something for you that's different than just life. This is why the Bible says, he who loves his life will lose it. He who loses his life shall gain it. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. It does not say to seek things. It says seek ye first kingdom of God. The principles of God, the kingdom work, right? Seek ye first that, and then things will be added unto your life. Follow me now. Life Jesus says, I came to give life, but life more abundantly. The life of Christ and in Christ is way more exciting than just life without Christ. Choosing the life that I want to live instead of choosing the life of destiny that God has actually provided for me. So you got God's will, and then you got your will. Get what I'm saying? So you'll know what decision you made, and you'll see the rewards of your decision in the end. In the end, you'll see the rewards of your decision. And if those rewards of your decision, and those rewards are not too rewarding, which is just keeping you down, there's no joy in the decision you made. It's a burden. Let me help you out. The Bible says, come unto me all ye that are heavy laden. And Jesus says, and I will give you rest. He says, give me your yoke, which is heavy, and I'll give you mine, which is easy. Give me your burden, which is light. Which is heavy. And he says, I'll give you my burden, with God's burden, which is light. So, the burden, give your burden that's heavy to God, and God will give you a light burden. Because you carry kingdom. You carry his will. You carry the will that's actually for you. His will. You don't want to do you. You want to do Jesus. And we have to be careful what we're listening to, because we're coming into a place where preachers are preaching a lot of, and it's good, you know, self-help. But I can only help myself for so long. I don't need a motivational help sermon. I need me some truth. And the truth motivates me to get some real help. Come on, talk to me today. That's what I need. Now, you have to help yourself, but you can only get so far with that kind of help. But when you run out of the strength that you have in your life, and you can say, Lord, I can't do this no more, but I can do all things through Christ, not through my strength, not through my mind, but through Christ who strengthens me. When I can't do it no more, I know that you can do it for me. The decision for destiny will prosper your life. There's times where you want to prosper and you want to be okay in life. But you don't want to chase life and have 2-3 different things that you're trying to accomplish just so you can enjoy life, and you're not enjoying life. And your children are not, they don't see. Come on, talk to me today. So what do we need to do? We need to start trusting God. We need to start coming back to having faith in God. We have to learn that when we give, He gives back unto us. In good measure, pressed down, shaken together. We don't have to press our minds to a place where we got to be on, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Guess what? That's the way Moses felt when he was in front of the Red Sea and the enemy was behind him. I don't know what I'm going to do. Let me share this with you. All our lives, we didn't know what we're going to do. But in faith in God, hasn't He brought you this far when you didn't know what you were about on the verge of divorce? You didn't know what was going to happen, but you trusted in God. When all failed, you trusted in God. You didn't lean on your own understanding. You trusted in the Lord, and God brought your husband back, brought your wife back. God is mending your marriage. No, you got to start believing. You cannot forget what God has done for your life. Come on. Now, I love, you know, amen. God has something that He created for you that is great. You don't just want to live life. Look here, 20 years. I'm gonna just jump 20 years for Joseph. In 20 years, he was 39 years old when he became Potiphar. Potiphar, 39 years old, young man. From when he got betrayed all the way to that point, it was about 20 years. 20 years in the making. 20 years you can get married and start a new family. 20 years you can move on with your life. In 20 years you can start a career, right? In 20 years you can build an empire. In 20 years you can become wealthy. If you do the right things, in 20 years, you can make yourself famous. In 20 years, you can be on the top of the world. But here's one thing you cannot do in 20 years. You can't erase a guilty conscience. No puedes borrar la conciencia. You can't erase a guilty conscience. And so the conscience is an odd thing, because it's the meter that tells us what's good and what's wrong. Now follow with me. Conciencia, que es bueno y que es mal. I see my granddaughter, and we like to see, you know, animals, videos of animals. She's seen this, you know, she's seen a monkey sleeping in bed. You know, it's like a cartoon thing. And the monkey had a fever. And when the monkey had a fever, it began to see things, and in the bottom there was sharks and all kinds of, you know, fish that would destroy the monkey, and the monkey was scared. My granddaughter, she looked at all the danger that the monkey was facing, and she wanted to, oh no. No one ever taught her that was dangerous. Would you have to understand that God already placed inside of you, when you know when you're wrong and you know when you're right. You can't come out of the place and say, well, I didn't know. No, you knew, man. Maybe at that point you didn't think about what you were going to say or do. But afterwards you said, oh, I shouldn't have done that. And I'm trying to help you out, because you might say, what's going on here? No, this is awesome. It's inside of you. So God is always, he placed a meter inside of you. And it doesn't matter what religion you come from. The education, la religión, la educación, the geographic, I don't care if you're from India, I don't care if you're from Egypt. It doesn't matter where you come from. You speak Spanish, you speak English, Chinese, Korean, Spanglish, English, you speak Aztec. I don't care what you speak. You still have the same conscience that every human family has in this entire world. It's part of God's origin. It's part of God's design. You get a conscience by because of God's design that he put inside of you. Every single human has that conscience. Some, that conscience is dead because they've been involved in so much evil that it's seared by with an iron. It's no longer able, that person is no longer able to turn back to repent. There's a place where, you can repent, where the Bible says, and he gives you over to your lust. But that's not what I'm going to preach on. But there's a point where what I'm saying is, people, you have inside of you, you have a conscience. But even then, having that conscience, it's not the same as having the Holy Spirit. Be the conscience is the meter that will tell you, hey, that's hot. Oh, that's cold. Hey, that was wrong. Hey, that's good. But the Holy Spirit will say, that's not my will. That's not what I want for you. And this is what the Holy Spirit does. Look, this is your meter. Good, bad. This is bad. Okay, I know I can't do that. This is good, okay. But this is the meter also, good. And you're doing good. And the Holy Spirit says, that's good, but that's not what I want you to do. Like this, that's good. I'm glad that that's good. Yes, that's good. But when are you going to start giving? That's good. I'm glad you're praying now, but that's good. But when are you really going to listen to the advice that came from God's word? But I'm here. That's good. But when are you going actually to give in when you're here? It has the power to compel your behavior. Conscience is like a street light that flashes from green, yellow, and red. You can still run the red light if you want to. I have, and I know you have too. Two minutes and two preaching. Yeah. So you can still run the light if you want to, but if you do run the red light, you've done something wrong. That's the conscience. Once you run that red light, you just sown that seed for retribution to come to you. Follow me now. Follow me. Joseph and I know I didn't read Genesis because I started preaching, right? But Jacob sends his sons. His sons, you can read it yourself, Genesis 42 to 43. That's a long chapter. Jacob sends his sons. His sons are in front of Joseph. They don't know that it's Joseph. Their brother, they betrayed. And they look and they bow down just like his dream. Just like the dream. Because 20 years later, God still had the last word. They betrayed him. They spoke bad about him. He was accused and all. But 20 years later, he was still there like, hey. Because God had a purpose. See, I'm going to teach you something, man. What you don't understand is this, and I want you to understand. People have to see the story as teaching. Joseph had to be where he was going to go. He had to be betrayed and had to go through all that so God can save Israel, Jacob, the family, the lineage. That it had to happen. The way it happened, it was going to happen. It's the way it was going to happen. See, you don't know what your leader is going through. You might not understand what your leader is going through. You might be one of the brothers, but you're not the leader. And you might not know what that leader is going through. But God, and let me teach you this. If the brothers would have known that Joseph was going to go through this for the sake for them to live and their family and their kids to live. This is what we're coming down to. So when a leader goes, he goes through something. Remember, the life of Joseph, God's raising him up. Because Joseph was a righteous man. Not a perfect man, righteous man. He was raising him up to help Israel. Joseph wasn't dead. He was far from it. And he was the prime minister of Egypt. And way down in Egypt, hundreds of miles away, through all the events that he went through, Joseph, God lift him up. Come on. The second most powerful man in the world. The second most powerful man in the world. And they're about, and the brothers are about to learn the law of sowing and reaping. And I'm going to teach you something here. What comes around, goes around. Sooner or later, the chickens come home to roost. Eventually, the skeletons come out of the closet. The brothers, it was 20 years. Bain Daniels, 20 years has passed. And this is why I title this, you got to what? Huh? Are you willing to face your past? Because if you're willing to face your past, if there's 20 years in your life that you still ain't dealing with something that your conscience is still messing with, come on, and the Holy Spirit is still convicting you about it, get things right. 20 years later, it's going to come out. I don't care what it is. It's going to come out. This is what I love repentance. I love to repent right away, man. What goes around comes around. Sowing bad seed with words is no good because you're going to get it. It comes back. Believe me, this is what I don't like doing. This is what I like. Sooner or later, the chickens come back to all the chickens go back home. Sooner or later, the skeletons come out of the closet. What are you saying? These brothers, they have to face the music. The hammer is coming down. This is why it's a series. I don't know, but in this series, there's 9 crucial questions, which I don't have time to give you. But this is one of them. Do you know why you were born? Number 2, do you know who you are. Number three, are you willing to wait for God? Not your time, God. How big is your faith in Him? But this is the question I want to leave you with tonight. Are you willing to face your past? Sooner or later, you have to face your past. The past that you haven't and that you don't want to deal with. Woo! I feel weird. Have you heard the scripture in Exodus chapter 21, 23, 24? A life for a life, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, a hand for a hand, a foot for a foot. Numbers 32:23. If you fail to keep your word, then you will have sinned against the Lord. And you may be sure that your sin will find you out. Galatians chapter 6 verse 7. Don't be misled. Don't be misled. Don't be deceived. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always have a harvest of what you plant, good or bad. 9 years have passed since Joseph's prime minister became not prime minister, excuse me. 9 years have passed since he became prime minister. I'm sorry. Everything has happened exactly as he said. The 7 good years were very good. Then there was 2 years and 7 lean years that were very bad. And now Joseph is 39 years old. And here is in the Middle East, there's a famine. Jacob comes, he hears that there's food in Egypt. Everything happens exactly the way God plans it to be. Joseph's dream is coming to pass. The story lies in between chapter 42 of the book of Genesis and chapter 43. And it summarizes the journey to Egypt, the meeting with Joseph, the journey back home, and then and journey back to Egypt, and then the journey back to the banquet. The brothers have no idea Joseph is still alive. Turn to your neighbor and says, you got to know that Jesus is still alive. Come on, hallelujah. Jesus is still alive. Yeah. They have no idea, but right in front of you, Jesus is the answer. Face up. He's right in front of you. Some people are bothered at times. I read stories about that. Joseph did not immediately identify to his brothers. Hey, it's me, Joseph. Joseph was a smart man. He wasn't going to do that. He wasn't just going to jump out and say, I'm your brother. Soy tu hermano. Good to see you guys. Hey, remember? Remember 20 years ago? Me dejaste ahí en el hoyo. You left me right there in the hole. You left me to die. My brothers, you left me to die. And oh man, I remember putting this down deep in his heart. Joseph was no Egyptian. Joseph had to learn to speak a different language. Joseph had to learn to eat a different food. He had to learn different culture. But he never forgot who his God was, no matter how high he went. It didn't matter how high he went. He never forgot who God was in his life. Somebody praise the Lord. See, God can raise you up, but you can't forget who God is in your life. Woo! Joseph. Throughout the years in Egypt and during the rise of power, he never forgot his father neither. He never forgot his dad, Jacob. He never stopped thinking about his brothers. He never said bad things about his family. You know what Joseph wanted? Joseph wanted his family back. Joseph wanted to reconcile, but he wanted it the way God wanted it. You know what Joseph was thinking about? Do they still hate me? Do my brothers still hate me? Will they own up to their treachery? Have they truly repented? Do they even want me back in the family? Do they even want me back again? I'm pretty sure that was going through his mind. That would be going through my mind. I don't care how big and how much money. You'd be thinking, I wonder if my family still cares for me. So Joseph takes the hard road and conceals his true identity so his brothers couldn't know who he was, and he doesn't have to reveal his true heart at that time. many a man who felt invincible in the, and it says, there's a statement that says, many a man who felt invincible in the sunshine had prayed in desperation when facing the midnight of suffering. The famine forced the brothers to go back into one place they never wanted to visit, Egypt. You know why? Because at some point, they knew that their brother, that's exactly where was everything was going down to, Egypt. So they were, he was sold as a slave, remember? He was sold as a slave. And they knew, man, we don't want to go over there because that's where he's, he might be. We don't know if he's alive. We don't know if he's dead, but we don't want, they didn't want to face their past. The brother, los hermanos no querían confrontar el pasado por lo que hicieron, lo que ellos hicieron a su hermano Joseph. They didn't want to. They didn't want. At some point, they didn't want to go, but they had. But God, God was going to force them to go back and make things right. You know why? Because this is the, that was the work of God. Jacob and the 12 sons, that was God's family. He said, you better get things together because he has a, no, you don't understand. God has a purpose for the brothers, and only for God to move the way he wanted them to move, there had to be a reconciliation among the brothers. And so then you start seeing what starts taking place. The loss of prosperity. And Jacob and Jacob's brothers, they were losing prosperity. They needed food. They were going to Egypt. But God made it that, God planted it that way. Destiny. Here's the turning point. I'm going to share something with you. Two things that will help you be free, and free for real. Free. Number one, what these brothers had to learn to do is confess their sin. Genesis chapter 42, 21. Turn me up a little bit. Give me a little up here. Speaking among themselves. The brothers were speaking among themselves. They say clearly, we are being punished because of what we did to Joseph a long time ago. We saw his anguish when he pleaded for his life and we didn't listen. Why? This is why we are in trouble right now. So the brothers, 20 years later, they start recognizing that we're reaping because of what we did to our brothers. I don't care who you are. It doesn't matter if you, don't matter if you are, you walk with Jesus. If your heart ain't right, you got to get it right. And the brothers, they knew it. They were talking to one each other and said, look it, let's not act stupid with each other. You know we're going through this. Tú sabes que estamos pasando por esto porque lo que hicimos. Hay que arrepentirlos. And he said, you know, this is what they said, speaking among themselves. Clearly, we're being punished because of this. You see what I'm saying? Now, right now, as I'm preaching this, you have to remember, confession is the key to freedom. They are on the road to repentance. As soon as they start talking, we're being punished because of what we did to Joseph a long ago. We heard him crying and we didn't listen to Joseph. And now we're being punished. Can you see these brothers? They can't sleep at night knowing that they did what they did to their brother. I don't know how a person can sleep at night when they turn on their brothers or when they do something to their families. And then they come and say, I'm being punished. Oh, I'm going through things. Repent and you'll be free. No, really. See, what I'm preaching here is that if I preach to you a message that you want to hear and it'll tickle your little ears, then it'll be good for you for 2-3 days, maybe for more than that. But you're never going to be challenged. I had a pastor once tell me, don't challenge the people. And I told him, well, you lost the fire somewhere, brother. Don't challenge? How about telling Deion Sanders, hey, don't run?
mean don't challenge? If we don't challenge the people and stir their spirits up, and the Bible says stir up the gift that was in you, they're not going to move. You're not going to have faith. You got to tell the mountain, be like, we go through trials, but the trial doesn't tell your life what to do. You tell that, move, move, move. You ain't got nothing here. Get out of my way. You ain't got no power. Move, mountain. Come on, somebody. 3 days, the brothers stayed in prison, and the Holy Spirit was talking to their memory. Not just that they hated him, not that they just planning something against him. Cuidado con los planes que, the plans, when someone plans things against you. Oh, but this is what they're going through. See, I want you to imagine, this is all the guilt that they're carrying. That's awful. Not just that they betrayed Joseph, not just that they threw him into the pit. They had to admit that they were wrong. They were remembering the, what does the Bible say? They remember the screams of Joseph. Ah, help me. Simeon, get me out of here. Stop playing around. Come on, Simeon. Levi, get me out of here. Come on, stop playing around. Hey, guys, where are you? Hey, brothers, come on. Hey. Been in the pit a couple times myself. I know what it is to shout out and cry for help. But I'll teach you something. Man never came for me. But just like Jesus came for Peter, Jesus came for me too. It's not the part, and for me, for you, what I'm saying is we all actually have been in places like that. You ever been in a place where you call it the pit? Some call it from the pit to the palace. I call it pit to purpose. Number one, confess. Admit that you're wrong. I was wrong. Somebody say, I'm wrong. Wrong. See, there's nothing wrong when your wife, when you ask, when you're talking to your wife, and you say, your wife, come on, just say, you know, babe, yeah, okay, I'm wrong. You know, a person doesn't want to be wrong because of pride. No, well, and even if, okay, yeah, you're right, but or you know, always got to say something without just absorbing it. Says, you know, I better learn something here. Number two, recognize God. This happens on the way back home when they discover that the silver in their sacks. This was the silver that they had taken to Egypt to buy the grain. The Bible says Joseph in Genesis 42, 25, 28, Joseph gave them the grain they wanted and secretly put the silver back into their sacks, giving the appearance that they had somewhat stolen it. Joseph is good. You know what Joseph was doing? I want him to come back. Because when they find out that there's silver, in their bag, they're going to go back and say, someone, hey, we have this in there. And they're going to say, you've been trying to steal from us. But Joseph was planning it because Joseph wants reconciliation. No. See, if Joseph didn't care, if he didn't care, this is what he would have done. Here's your food. Here's your food. Groups, come get your food, man. Food. Here's your bag. and I wouldn't have to. If he didn't care, he would just left them like that. Go. And don't come back no more. Because you know what? You betrayed me. You turned on me. You sold me. You know what? Now I'm on the top. And you're going to, yeah, and I'm going to make you suffer, boy. Because I'm the top now. Is that the attitude Joseph had? Is that the attitude Joseph had? Is that the attitude you should have with somebody? He says, you're going to come. He goes, no, he didn't have that attitude. He wanted to see the hand of God work. God's spirit never left them alone. Even during the long years in Canaan, when they thought that Joseph was dead, they remembered Joseph screaming in the pit. Remember? I just read that. They remembered what he did, what they did to the little brother, how they hated him, how they envied him, how they plotted against him, how they cast him into the pit, how they ignored his cries for help, how they sold him as a slave, and how they lied to their own father. Oh, come on. Hallelujah. It's an ugly event that took place at that time. But they had this guilt inside of man. Now the things turned against them in Egypt. The Holy Spirit taps them in the shoulder. Remember what you did to Joseph. This is connected to that. And the brother seen, we're going through this because what we did to Joseph, we're going to be free from this when we confess and repent. Psalms 51:6 says, behold, you desire truth in an inward parts, and the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. True repentance always involves coming clean. True repentance always involves owning up to the pattern of being wrong. Not just getting caught doing wrong and then you say, I'm wrong. Admitting that you were wrong. It says, God, I'm wrong. Pastor, I'm wrong. Brother, I'm wrong. Sister, I'm wrong. Family member, I'm wrong. Wife, husband, I just want to make things better. Let's reconcile things. Let's pray that God brings peace into our lives. Because, you know, it's beautiful when you're honest. And when you're honest, God moves in an honest heart. And an honest heart, God moves in honesty. And your family begins to get healed. And you start seeing healing take place in your family. Three hard words that sometimes people have a hard time to say. I am guilty. I was wrong. For 20 years, the brothers had covered up their sin, and they stiffed their conscience. They say that's why some people do drugs, so they won't have to think about the past. Not everyone does it for that reason, but they say there's some that do. Joseph was awakened. He was given wisdom. The Holy Spirit opened the eyes. 20 years passed. And the Holy Spirit is still connecting the divine. Come on. The Bible says, and Jacob, their father, said to them, You have bereaved me. Joseph is no more. Simeon is no more. And you want to take Benjamin? All these things are against me. Because he was asking, he says, keep Benjamin, the youngest brother. No, no, no. Joseph was playing hard. Come on, somebody say amen. But Joseph wanted everybody. He wanted to know his little, he wanted to know his little brother. He just wanted the family back. God set everything up. And Joseph finally revealed himself. It's a long story, but he revealed himself to his brothers and to his father that he missed so much of that. I'm alive. Come on. And everything was for a purpose. See, Christ came to save sinners like Joseph came to save Egypt. Run to the cross like the brothers ran. See, the brothers ran because they needed to eat. The doors are open in the Father's house. Come on. The lights are on, brother. God is still moving. You don't have to be turned away. Just face it. Make things right in your life. You don't have to sleep in peace. Have a good night's sleep for once. You can say, wow, I can sleep because I ain't got nothing to worry about. I ain't mad at nobody. I'm good. You're not worried about no attacks because you know what? The battles are his. I don't have to fight. He fights my battle. He fights our battles. No, there's a time right now where God wants to deliver some of you from that conscience. That conscience that's been just eating you up, talking about, I have to get things together in my life. You're watching online, you're watching right there. Someone's watching online. You're hearing what God's saying, the Lord's speaking to you. This is your moment for you to just bow your heads and start thinking about what the word has been speaking to in your heart. What do you want to choose? Life or destiny? Destiny is what God has already has planned for you. You can choose that. Or you can choose your will and work twice as hard, five times as hard, and try to make things happen your way. But you're not going to be happy. You're not have no joy. Your family's going to suffer. But we'll do it God's way. He says, God, I surrender all. Stand on your feet. I surrender all. Lord, thank you, Jesus. You are worthy, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Don, we need this. We need this. We need the Holy Spirit to go overtime in our church now. We need some overtime. We get overtime at work. We need overtime with Jesus. You put in 2-3 hours for work, we're going to put 2-3 hours for Jesus. How's that? Come on, somebody. If we put our lives into life, we need to put our life into Jesus. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Come on, someone. The name of Jesus. Come on. Are you ready? Lift up the hands. Come on, are you ready? Come on, lift up the hands. Worship. Say with me, Father in heaven, I need you. I repent. I need my heart to get right. Come on, say it. There's times when I'm wrong. I'm not always right. Pride, move out of my life. Come on. Envy, out. Jealousy, out. Gossip, out. Bring peace, love, joy, self-control. Come on, somebody. Talk to me today. Thank you, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. I'm going to open this altar. I'm going to leave it like that for right now. We'll sing a song. Let's sing a worship song. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord.